I will not say this is the requirement post COVID. This is the same requirement even pre COVID also. If you want to really prepare the students to be ready for industry, whether it is a pre COVID situation or post COVID situation, they should know the strong understanding of engineering fundamentals, physics, electronic circuits, control systems, signal processing, right? Ability to solve problems, ability to prioritize. For example, today I have to do hundreds of things, but I should be in the position to prioritize what to do first, which one I have to do first. Similarly, as a student, you may have hundreds of things to do today. You may wanted to do chatting. You may wanted to do some time in Netflix. You may wanted to do some time with games. You may wanted to attend some lab sessions and class sessions. So you should be in the position to prioritize. System level thinking, creativity, leadership. So the industries are saying, when we wanted to recruit engineers from a engineering college, whether it is a tier one or tier two or tier three engineering college, we are not bothered, but we are bothered about whether they are in the position to demonstrate all these skills. How do they demonstrate? Probably doing some internship, probably doing some projects in the second year level, third year level, probably doing a capstone project in the final year or pre-final year, right? Or working on some of the competitions, multidisciplinary, right? So if you're working on working for a project for a national level competition, you should also know whether I can able to collaborate with electrical engineers, mechanical engineers, computer science engineer, even in that case MBA students to build a system. So these are all the typical skills what industry is looking from a fresh engineering graduate. Okay, this is the third important message we all should remember. The fourth one, what for? So if you look at the first three slides, we are talking about the technology evolution happening. We looked at the new normal in education system. The third one, we also looked at what are the typical skills wanted by these industries. So why? What for all these are required? Because we are interested to solve the global grand engineering challenge. That is what Prime Minister Modi also sometime back said, self-reliant, Atmanirban, right? This is possible provided if you and me, industry and academic, work together and prepare the students with industry standard technology in the new normal education system by demonstrating the competencies and skills required by the industry for solving problems, challenges. It may be getting a clean water. It may be developing a better medicine. It may be an improvement of infrastructure in the rural and urban. That may be secured cyberspace. That may be preventing from the nuclear terror. We know what is happening in India, China, Pakistan borders, right? That may be personalized learning. Today, we all have a biggest problem. My daughter have a problem. 3.5-year-old, she has to spend 1.5 hours, 1 hour in online mode of education. Still, she's not able to follow. Personalized learning. That is the reason Baiju is very, very popular today, right? UN Academy. So all these things are the 21st century grand challenges, and that will be solved one and only by engineers. And those engineers are currently in our classroom, in our interaction. So if we take this situation very boldly and focus on engaging the students, exciting the students, empowering the students, then we can able to prepare a very good engineer who can solve all these challenges, even though the environment is not normal. And please remember, we cannot miss this precious 3 months of time or 6 months of time, because the rate of discovery is very, very important. You cannot say, okay, anyway, the government of Andhra or government of Tamil Nadu decided to make all the students pass. Today, we are not preparing our students to get a degree. We are preparing our students to become an engineer rather than engineering degree holder. So the 3 months time or 6 months time, which we are stuck very heavily because of the COVID, still we should know what are the different ways we can engage the students. And if we know how to engage the students, I'm sure we can prepare the students who can be a contributor of solving the 21st century problems. Okay. So now we look at the challenges, right? Now I'm going to take you quickly. How do we prepare in engaging the students effectively so that they will be ready for industry? The best method, with my experience, is doing. If you keep on teaching the theory, actually I was talking to almost a good number of colleges last 4 or 5 months, basically the post-COVID situation, I got a different type of inputs. Recently, a few colleges, they are giving an answer, sir, we have moved all our labs to next semester. Thinking that the situation become normal, the students will be allowed to come to the campus. That may be okay, but to be very frank, that means this whole semester you are going to teach where the students are just going to hear, there is very high probability they will forget when they come to next semester and perform the lab experiment. But in the given situation, how do we prepare the students to do engineering so that they will understand right now, not waiting for next year, February month, third week to do a filter experiment or amplifier experiment or oscillator experiment. Okay, globally, because this is not the problem of Andhra Pradesh or Tamil Nadu or government of India, right? It's a global problem. Everybody facing a challenge. How do we engage the students? How do we excite the students? How do we empower the students in the remote way, particularly in the lab, so that they will become a good engineer? See, if it is arts and science program, I'm really not bothered because there is no much significant lab component involved. But when it comes to the engineering, significant percentage is doing. If they are not spent enough time in the lab, they cannot understand. If they're not understanding, they cannot able to solve the problem. If they're not able to solve the problem, they cannot become an innovator. They cannot discover some new things, right? So the lab is important for us engineers. So these are the commonly used techniques. One is a simulation. The other one is a video recording. The other one is a remote lab. And student-owned device is one more option. So I'm not here to tell you which is best, which is not best. I'm just sharing how people have started adapting some of the technology to engage the students for lab side. Simulation, you all aware, right? Any lab, it may be an electrical circuit lab, or it can be a control system lab, or it can be a machines, electrical machines lab, or it can be a thermodynamics lab, whatever may be the lab. There are some software available. There are tools available where you can use a proprietary software to do a simulation, or there are pirated version or open source softwares are available where still you can continue to do a simulation. That is one level of engagement. The second level of engagement is because the government of India is saying the students are not recommended to come to the campus, but 50% of the faculties can come in the cyclic method. That means the faculty can go to the lab, conduct the experiment, record everything, and share it to the students in a YouTube or Microsoft Teams Live or WhatsApp way. At least what the students can do, they can remotely see in a recorded experimentation, and they'll try to understand how to conduct the experiment step by step. That is another method. I will combine these two and put one common name called virtual. Because in this method, the students are not really doing anything. Really, what I mean real means interacting with the real world signal or real hardware or real components. Everything is simulated here in this first two environment. The second method, because these two are combined, right, as one method virtual. This method is called remote lab is very interesting concept. This is not the need of today, even it was the need of last 10 years. I will tell you why. Every college, if you go to lab in every department, you can see huge amount of investments made by the management or governments. They are given the grant in terms of DST project or AICT project. But those hardwares are used only in the college working hours because we are not IIT. We are not from IIC. Even to the extent we are, NITs are not operated in 24/7 mode. So most of the colleges in India, we are given with access morning 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock, till night 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock. That means the another 12 hours, the investments, whatever made by the government, made by the colleges, not used. The first problem is, as a management, I invested a crore for setting up a RF lab or a solar lab or smart grid lab, but the student's utilization, the research scholar's utilization is just only 12 hours per day. Remaining 12 hours, it is idle. The first problem from the management side, government side, who is invested. The second side, students level. Look at the students. See, I'm not a smart student like others. I may be a slow learner. I wanted to do the experiment at least 2-3 times to understand. Today I'm limited. I have to go and catch the bus at 4:30. Otherwise, I will not go back to my home on time. Right? So if the students are able to access those hardware after 7 o'clock, after 8 o'clock, then the students' learning also will go higher. So the remote lab is a concept. It is basically a concept to provide access of all the investments, whatever you made in the campus, to the student's hand or researcher's hand. Right? I'm also going to show you a demonstration, and Professor Shivakumar sir also going to show you a demonstration how the investment made by LBRCE management on setting up a virtual instrumentation center of excellence almost 10 years before, in active today, still today, I will not say today, still today, almost last 10 years, and how the technology is helping the students 24/7 to perform the experiments. The another method is the own device. See, I cannot demand my management to provide access of the hardware 24/7. There are a lot of issues, power issues, internet issues, server issues, cloud interface issues, so many issues which I cannot control. The management is willing to support, but still, if the internet is slow, what management can do, right? So if I able to build a lab, if I able to build a lab at my home and continue to do the experiments, whatever my professor is teaching in the classroom or online mode, and I can able to empower my learning, and that is called a student-owned device. So as a summary, there are commonly used three online education when it comes to the laboratory. One is a virtual, everything is simulation. The other one is a remote access of the hardware, which is already available in the campus. Basically, IoT is a technique or AI as the method they will use. The third one is pocket lab. Student will own the lab in their home or in their backpack. So with this, what will happen? Some engagement. It will not be zero. But at the same time, I will not say it is equivalent to the classroom environment or lab environment in the campus. But it will be better not doing anything, right? And that is what these three options are. I'm quickly show you small details about these three things. One is called student own software. That means you own a software like Multisim, like LabVIEW, because these two are from National Instruments, NI. So I took this as an example. So Multisim is basically a circuit simulation software, and LabVIEW is a graphical system design software. With this software, you can able to do everything in a virtual mode. The first option which we were discussing, right? Virtual. The second option, remote lab, using a hardware called Elvis from NI, you can able to perform good number of labs. That means the Elvis hardware will be in the college and students will access the hardware remotely. Okay. The third one is have a lab in your home. My DAQ, my RIO, analog discovery. So these are the hardwares specifically developed for student purpose. Students will own these devices. How you are owning laptop, how you are owning your own smartphones, right? The same way, if you want to become a good engineer, you should own a lab with you. And that is called student-owned device. So I will take you very quickly the three methods, the student-owned software. We have a software called LabVIEW. You can see all our LabVIEW family tools. LabVIEW for IoT, LabVIEW for communication, LabVIEW for signal processing, LabVIEW for filter design, LabVIEW for control system, LabVIEW for machine learning, LabVIEW for electrical power, LabVIEW for MATLAB interfaces, even LabVIEW for your Arduino board interfaces, Raspberry Pi interfaces. So these all are packaged as a LabVIEW family. And there is another software, Multisim. So with this package, you can perform almost 20 different type of labs in your engineering. So with one software called Multisim, you can perform all these labs. With another set of software, LabVIEW, along with the toolboxes, you can perform another 10, 15 labs. But these all are virtual. Okay. Multisim, I'm sure most of you are aware. Otherwise, I will show you a quick demonstration. Today, if you don't have a laptop, still you can able to program the circuit simulation using a web portal. For example, there is a Multisim live and you can able to build your own circuit. What I will do, I will show you a circuit which I already built. Or I can show you quickly build a circuit also in front of you. I can drag and drop the component required for my circuit. For example, I will build a simple RC filter, right? And then take a ground. And what else you need? You need a power source. I mean the signal source, and start wiring all this. I'm not using mouse, that's why a little bit challenges I'm facing. Okay. Right. Same way. Ground. And what else? This way we have to wire, right? The moment you go closer to this point, you will get it. Okay, right now, if some of you can calculate 1 kilo ohm and 1 microfarad is the value I have used. And this is the 1 volt, 1 kilohertz is the source. If you calculate the cutoff frequency, then you will get 120, 140 hertz as the cutoff frequency. Let me run the program. The right side, okay. So it says very clearly, connect the probe to view the data. Right now it is not connected. Where do you want to see the data? So I want to see the data across my input, across my output, right? Okay, the green is the input, which is a 1 volt, 1 kilohertz. Blue is the output, which is will be seen in the graph. So right now it is a 1 kilohertz. You can see the amplitude of the output is reduced. And if I go ahead and change the frequency, right now it's 100 hertz. Can you see my amplitude of my input signal as well as output signal almost the same? How long it will be same? If it is 300 hertz, it is reduced. 240 hertz, 190 hertz, almost up to 120, 130 hertz, the amplitude is exactly the same. As I increase the frequency above 120 hertz, which is the cutoff frequency, right? it is reduced. And this software is completely free for you. There are two options. Either you can use a free subscription mode with limited features, or you can buy a premium access with all the features, right? But free subscription also available where you are interested to use with a limited number of features to perform your lab experiments. So the idea is, if you start doing everything in the simulation, that is the first point you have to encourage your students to engage, experiment, right? Once the students are able to spend a decent time in the simulation level, either in the LabVIEW software or multisim software like this, and then you can slowly move it to remote access of the hardware. And the hardware is, which I mentioned earlier, Elvis hardware. It's a very interesting hardware, you can see. It has all the instruments integrated for you. You don't need to have these many instruments separately in your lab. It has oscilloscope, it has function generator, it has IV analyzer, pattern generator, power supply, multimeter, everything available as a one device. And you can also see it has a A to D, D to A converters, 16 channel analog input, 4 channel analog output, power supply, and 40 DAO lines. So with this one hardware, what you can do, you can build the circuit, right? So can you see here? I built the circuit. It may be amplifier circuit or oscillator circuit or op-amp circuit or a simple diode characteristic circuit, or it can be a biomedical signal conditioning circuit, anything. You can build the circuit there, and you can wire the respective input output for your circuit, because I said it has all the instruments, and you can give access to your students, and students can able to do the experiment remotely. How it will happen? You can see this is the way it will happen. One second. Okay. Can you see here? This circuit was developed and kept in the campus. This is in the campus. This device is in the campus. The circuit was built by the lab technician or a faculty member in the campus, and all the wiring were done. Now students, what they will do? They will log into a URL, see video streaming. And then they will able to take the real-time measurements of this experiment, whatever they built. I will also show you a quick demo how it can be done. So now what I will do, I will go to a measurement live. Can you see here? Because I'm going to take measurements from the real hardware, real component. But the hardware is in my office. I'm in another location. So how do I do it? So I will go to measurements live, and then I will select the device, how it is connected to my computer. Right now, the device is somewhere that is connected in the network. So that device has a device ID. So that is the ID I have used here, and I will click connect. Now what will happen? The device will be detected and connected with my laptop through a Wi-Fi. So fail to communicate. Let me close it and check once again. Measurement live. Okay, measure, network, device ID. It's a case sensitive, so you have to be careful whether you are using a right ID with the proper case. NI, small c, capital X, 982, capital X, 37. Yeah, this is right. Let me see if this is not connected. Yeah, it is connected. See, it is connected. You can get a disconnect option now. So now we'll go to a instrument, because the same circuit what I simulated, RC filter circuit, is implemented and ready for access. I want to see the frequency response of that signal. Oh, 12:30. Okay, let me close it and then I'll transfer it to Shivakumar sir, and then he will show some of the labs how they are implementing in their campus. So now the circuit is implemented in the Elvis hardware, available in my office. I'm connecting that device through an internet. The device is detected, and I can able to see a video streaming of the circuit, and I will run the same program here, where I'm taking a real measurement. So we already tested the circuit in the simulation, right? It's a 120 hertz is a cutoff frequency. So can you see here the 3 dB point? So it's a 100 hertz and minus 1.6 dB, right? 3 dB point, if you can move it, and you can able to match with your simulation, theoretical result, and the real-time result. And this platform will help you to do a collaborative learning. So one of you from the participant, I will copy-paste this code in the chat box. You can also log in, and you can also learn together, and then you can also ask the doubts, and I can also help you where you stuck to support. So one of you can try. I have shared the device ID in the chat box. So what you have to do, go to Google Chrome or Firefox. I recommend Chrome. Type measurements live. Measurements live. This is the NI cloud server. Will help you to integrate with the NILV3 hardware wherever you are present. Measurements live. The moment you click measurements live, you will get a device ID. You have to enter USB option, network option. Go to network option. There is a device ID. Measurement live, measure, and then network. In here, enter the device ID. Copy paste the ID here. Then what will happen? You will also able to join with me here, and then you can able to run the program. So some of you can try. In meanwhile, I'll move into the next one. The third one is owning the lab yourself, either a MyDAC or MyRio or Analog Discovery. So these are the different platforms. These are the miniature version of high-end industrial graded hardware or NILV's hardware. But the importance is this hardware will help your students to do many experiments labs on their own choice. For example, if you take MyDAC as a device, along with your MyDAC, if you have a breadboard and components, you can able to wire it appropriately, and then you can perform variety of experiments. Because this small device have all the instruments required. You don't need to have a separate function generator or scope or multimeter. It has all the source as well as measuring instruments. And it also have a USB interface to your computer. That is a way the students in your region, I can take example, KLU Vijayawada, they encourage the students to own a MyDAC from their first year so that they can learn most of the concepts by doing in the classroom as well as in their home. And what you can do almost 8 to 10 different type of subjects, labs using this device, and a lot of courses, materials available also. So these are the three methods. Right now, what I will do, I will stop here, and then I will request Professor Shivakumar sir to take a control and then share how you are performing some of the labs in the electrical department, electronics and communication department, and mechanical department using National Instrument Center of Excellence to conduct various labs, sir. Sir, what I will do, I will disconnect the screen, basically the stop sharing. You can take a complete control, sir.
Sir, sir, am I audible?
Yeah, perfect, sir.
Good afternoon for all the participants. I'm Shivakumar from ABRC. Till now, we have seen the almost all the developments, and as we are all the lab use centers, we are using the equipment for our purpose, right? For our purpose. So at this moment, the equipment which are available in the labs as it is, when we connect through our virtual instruments, maybe the voltage and current, whatever we measure, most of the electronic experiments we can do directly. Whereas even in electrical, we could work out. But when we are coming to the mechanical department, straight away I'm coming down. As it is, we could use our Myrios or Serio modules to connect various inputs and see various outputs. As we know, the virtual instruments we can also design and we can use them. The same moment, when the equipment is connected through these things, the readings could be monitored on our screens normally with many of the instruments. But for them to give simulation, like today, we'll be going through some of the experiments which we are conducting through the virtual labs. Virtual lab means like this. The equipment is available in our lab. These things we interface through our the NI hardware, like Elvis, the MyDAX, and then Serio modules. We have analog inputs, analog outputs, digital outputs. So these things. So at present, we are using this in our mechanical lab, Serio module. So when we are using these modules, then the inputs and outputs, if we could control from the virtual instruments on the monitor, in the same way as we are just watching and taking the control in these online mode, right? Using whether it is Microsoft or otherwise Google Meet or otherwise Cisco WebEx, anywhere, we can give the control to our students and then ask them just to control the devices. When the function generator is here, when the oscilloscope is here, the filter circuit, which I want, we're next showing it. So the filter response as it is, they could vary the frequency and see the output on the oscilloscope. This is where in the first year when they come into the college, we have the EDC lab, and that's where we introduce virtual instruments to all the students, computer science, IT, mechanical, electrical, electronics, for all the students. We have EDC lab in first and second semesters. So at that moment, for four experiments or five experiments, we bring them. They do the same experiment there also in our EDC lab using the real normal instruments, oscilloscope, function generator, multimeter, everything. Then come down, do the same experiments using virtual. Here are our virtual instruments, the oscilloscope, and then function generator, multimeter, everything. That's where they were introduced. Thereby, they have the little idea about it, so they are using it. So the same things if I share on the screen through these softwares. Now they are just, they could vary and see the signals, take the readings. One more thing if I say, when we are doing in the batches, some 3-4 people will be working on a kit. So at that moment they will be taking the readings. But here the same thing could be visible to their entire group. So for that purpose, what exactly we require? In a lab, we have 12 experiments, 15 experiments, 15 weeks, 12 weeks. So at that moment, let us connect either this MyDAC with additional hardware if required, because we know the current rating of every analog output, digital output, analog output is very less. That's why we had a paper as it is by one of the US researcher, that by just add a driver, transfer driver to the circuit, op-amp driver to the circuit, like TL072, works on supply. So just connect it and take the analog output as the input to the driver. Thereby, the driver output we will use with the same, the 15 volts, as it has 30 milliampere current rating, we can have the higher the current rating of 30 milliampere. So as we are going through diode and transistor characteristics, this is the difficulty. So when we are looking at the voltage, the diode current goes up to 20 milliampere, 25 milliampere, but the analog output cannot drive. So a simple driver circuit is enabling us to deliver this much of current to the circuit without any external supply. now in a in the lab, even we need not go for that, right? So that means a driver circuit is a must, or otherwise if we connect a power supply, what happens? The power supply has to be varied by us, so half of the circuit once again we are taking. So that's where this small addition of the circuit will make my DAC to deliver the higher currents at the analog outputs. Specifically, I am saying, thereby analog output, whenever we are varying, we can see the outputs, right? So these things they could see, they could store, then as we record, then they, it will be available in streams, so that they can check up, once again come back. So when that is, as we are coming to the college, they got faculty and staff, so labs are open and equipment is available, so we connect these things through, we have somewhere around the 9 MIDACs and then 5 LVs and somewhere around 5 to 6 serial modules, but 2 are analog and once again 1 is digital, 1 is for motor control, like this. So this as it is, CYE was established in somewhere around 10 years back, 2010-11. So from there we were just introducing LabVIEW for every person, for every people, right, for every students in the first year, second year, so that they can go for, so who are all interested, they would do mini projects, right? That is entirely, that's what normally happens in every our LabVIEW centers. This is very common. So bringing this application here, what I mean is, as we are increasing the analog output current with a simple driver, we require a driver circuit for that. So as we electronics people, right, if we develop that driver circuit and put it at the MIDAC, really external power supply is not required. This MIDAC itself will drive. The 20 kilohertz frequency function generator will serve for most of the purposes. Otherwise, we generate, right? We could, as it is, we are using LVs where we have up to 250 kilohertz. So at this moment, we have that one. Okay, thereby we can generate the frequency, and the monitoring purpose or multimeters will do, our the oscilloscope will do. If I want to have the higher currents, right, the millivolt outputs of digital meters, we can interface. Otherwise, even the shunts, which are used for current measuring, 10 amps, 15 amps, 20 amps, which gives normally 75 millivolts output or something, the shunts we can connect it to our meters. Yesterday I have found, to when we are extending the usage for one of the breakdown, break test, there the 10 to 15 amperes, 19 amperes, 20 amperes are required, electrical. So at that moment, the applying the load is once again a rotation, manually they rotate. So at present, till we develop a driver circuit for rotating it, if I could design a driver and give the control with a virtual instrument, is it not possible for the students to vary the control, and then there the pressure will be increased, the load will be increased? At present we have the manual one. So now our job is this year to convert most of the experiments to these with these interfacing devices. Why I am discussing is, sir, I request, I as it is, kindly put on before you, the, as we are working from various departments with this, working with the different experiments, what all the things when we are interfacing those things with our MIDACs and LVs, what this LVs has, if I want to switch on and off, can I have the control here? We have the digital IO lines, which I can use it for switching on, switching off the relay. From there onwards, I can switch on anything, switch off anything, like thermal labs, the heater on, heater off, you can do with this. Just connect a relay driver and then require another driver, we could put it. So finally, we control. So little addition of circuits to make all the experimental setups to be interfaced to the MIDAC or otherwise our LVs. So these NNI hardware equipments. So with a little investment, if we make them, maybe another semester, we may have to have the students come to the session or something like this. So till that moment, even at this moment, whatever we are sharing, we may have to share, thereby they themselves conveniently, even in the college time, we leave one system connecting the MIDAC and then that equipment. So at that moment, they could straight away start the controlling, do the control and then take the readings, anything. Only our system should be on, the equipment should be connected, should be ready. Once if I give the control, then for our students' purpose, when we are logging in the Teams, every time we need not give the control for them. They themselves could shift the control from one to the other. This is what one more advantage. So once if I start, then all the logged in people who are allowed, they are available one after the other, right? So one person, he works the notes down the things, and who are all interested, he can request and then take the control. So this is where even in 2 hours lab, whatever we are providing, just we can rotate, right? Rotate for 10 batches, at least 20 minutes for every experiment batch. Even four people, five people, now virtually any number of people, they could, right? So at that moment, we can give control one for one person in that team, thereby he can vary and take the readings, but those readings are visible for every student in that section. So this is what the advantage, what we are as it is experiencing, and most of you might have started with, but what I am facing is the interfacing circuits are required to interface the electrical, mechanical, civil, experimental setups to these things. Say even the physics, right? These experimental setups, once if we interface, then it will give us the control with virtual instrument. I can have a virtual knob. I can have a knob. That is what we are constructing VIs. Those are the same VI we construct. We can include it as an instrument, additional instrument plus in the instrument launcher of either Elvis or MyDAC. So this is where the virtual instruments really making the students to experience that, yes, they are doing it. Why? They have already experienced how they have done with the basic equipments, the in the EDC lab conventional equipment of oscilloscope, function generator, multimeter, and that the same they have done when they have to come to the college in the last year. At that moment, they have done it. So the same thing, now if I share it, right? So whatever they are wearing on the screen, they could vary. With camera, we could show the setup, we could explain the connections, everything. And also through the videos, the YouTubes, whatever normally we used, the same setup we use. This is basically with the inspiration of virtual labs by our IITs, who really made without any hardware, they can go for and really experience the things. Then at that moment, with this much of hardware, with the LabVIEW NI hardware interfaced with the LabVIEW, as we have virtual instruments on hand, why could not we expand our working for all the departments? Thereby, really every experiment could be done, so that even in the next stage, as ACT chairman sir is discussing, like providing the technology for all, like at the same moment we could share these things for our students, if required, for even for others. So this is where just I am going with a demo, like I will be giving the control to the other setup, thereby we could see. I will be showing the one of these filters, high pass filter, which we have constructed on the Elvis. Elvis have up to 250 kilohertz. So, but that is to be interfaced to a system through the bus interface card. So slightly expensive, but at the same high frequency range, since we are using it. So, switch on. Ramkrishna. Just a moment, we will be logging in and then we will be giving the control. Harika. Login and control. Login and control. You could log in and request control. Other remote. You are control. Can I give the control request control? Request panel. I will share it. One minute. I will share. So I'm coming back. Cam is connected. Elvis screen we have to share. Share the screen. Asagar, share the screen. This is the setup you can show just. Share the screen. Mir kada share leda.
Share content.
Anushka, share the screen. Desktop, share desktop. Ok sir, just Elvis show. Circuit should be, just show this circuit. Sir, this is Elvis, where we have on the front panel, the function generators and all. Function generator. Sir, this is regarding the high pass filters, where the frequency could be varied, and the input-output signals. The same thing we are sharing to the other people, the students, for our faculty. Thereby, you could say time division, time per division oscilloscope. You can just vary thereby things. So increase the frequency. Function generator on, can vary the frequency. Still. Output we can see. High pass filter. Increasing. So this is where this control as it is, these two controls vary the frequency. When I give the screen control to the students or otherwise the other participants, they will be really working with the same, going ahead with just taking the readings as they are taking with our instruments, right? Same experience. So with the simple, the Elvis part, but still we are gone up to only 20-25 kilohertz, but it is could go up to 250 kilohertz. So this part. I think these things regarding the high pass filters, which could be done with the MyDAC itself, but up to 20 kilohertz, only one change. Whereas when we go back to that particular one with Elvis, we can go up to high frequencies. Okay, so I am taking back the control and giving it to other frequency modulation kit, where the kit is available. So there, instead of the internal function generator, we are giving our signal source and looking at the outputs. Okay, request control. Hello, I have given the request control. Allow it. Allow, above. Top. Yes. No. Given the control, okay. You have given the control, you have to give the control, red line. Red line, click it. Just click the red line, please. Red line center. not the join. No, I am coming. Just leave the control. Leave the control so that. Yes. This is the frequency modulation, the output and input which we are observing. This we have connected with a MyDAC. Thereby. No, just give the control. Control. Just show the kit. Show the kit. Show the kit. Take the control. Not allow me. Take the control and then. Take the control, show the kit, camera. Just show the camera kit. Show the camera kit, your camera. Your cam. Request control. Give request control. As control, you have to give request and then request for control. Take the control, show the cam. Cam should be that our kit should be visible. Switch on the camera, kit should be visible. Yes, you have the control now. Sir, you don't have the control, I believe. Asagar. You don't have the control. Our camera has to be. I'm sure. Digital frequency modulation kit. Camera, we have to show. Still Elvis camera is coming up here. Okay, from your participant, okay. That's okay. In your screen it is appearing. Here. Other demo kit has to. Yes, the frequency modulation kit where we have the signal and carrier. The carrier frequency is fixed 80 kilohertz, and the signal frequency which we have signal generator, there the input is replaced by our function generator output. Thereby what is happening now, the function generator output which we are varying is applied as a signal. Thereby the modulated output is connected to once again demodulator. Above half part is modulator, the below part is demodulator. So the demodulator output is connected, thereby the demodulated signal, once again we are observing it on the screen. So two channels, the function generator output and then share the function generator output, function generator and oscilloscope. Function generator, just take it side. Vary the frequency, please. Still. Increase. Come to kilohertz. Right. That's so. Both inputs and output, both the channels are available. So I could. Just bring it to the side. Bring it onto the screen. Yes. Both the channels are enabled. The signal as it is, we can vary and then see the outputs. Share them. The control, same things they will share. They will be accessing and they could go. they could do it. This is available on the kit. In some of the kits, the signal generator is also directly soldered. So at that moment, we have a little difficulty. We have to break that path, and then we have to provide like our signal at that moment. Once again, if the kit has to work, then that particular circuit path has to be completed as it is, we solder. So that small thing, we have to take a little risk on that kit. Thereby, the external signal from our function generator, instead of the function generator which is available on the kit, if we give, really the control will be in our hands, in our students' hands. So this is where the kit part. So, okay, you can release the control. Now, screen share, just you can remove. You can remove screen share. Stop screen sharing.
Stop presenting.
Okay. So now I will ask Giridhar sir, I will give the control. Sir, Giridhar sir, kindly request for the control. Take the control, sir. Giridhar sir. Request for the control.
Yes, sir. It is
true,
sir.
Control is there? Okay. Sir, your SAR firing circuit.
Yes, sir.
You could just explain and show the meters. Or multimeter oscilloscope also, you could explain the circuit, sir. Sir, over to Giridhar, sir. Professor Giridhar, sir, from EEE department, sir.
Sir, I think it is audible. Is it audible?
Sir, your voice is audible, very clear.
Right, sir.
But your circuit.
I think VD also, your switched on or setup is also visible, right?
Sir, we screen sharing.
Yes, sir. We are in electrical and electronics engineering department, LBRC. And this is a power electronics lab. So we have put a experimental setup of a full bridge rectifier circuit, okay. The switches used here are the thyristor. Let me share the circuit diagram and the document of the manual so that it will be clear. One second, please. I am sharing the Word document. Okay. So this is the actual setup of the full bridge converter. So we are taking a supply of 230 volts.
Sir, after sharing, take the
which is down to.
Sir, select the desktop AC, after sharing. Is it visible, sir? Word document.
Yes, sir. I think document is visible.
Okay.
Right.
Visible?
So 230 volts is the main supply from which we have stepped down the voltage to 12 volts. Okay, where we are nearly getting 9 or 10 volts because the NI MIDOC will function up to 10 to 12 volts only. So we have stepped down the voltage to 12 volts and given the supply to the bridge.
Sir, voice break. Voice is coming.
AC is coming.
Yes.
Okay. Now this is the actual setup. Now let me change the. One second, please. I'm removing the sharing of document. Okay. Now I think circuit is visible, and the top kit is the firing circuit for the four thyristors, and this is the thyristor bridge circuit, okay. And we have put a resistive load of 120 volts by 2 ampere, and this is a digital oscilloscope, okay. So let me share, and multimeter is also there for reading the average value output, since we get an output DC, right. So let me change the firing angle. So accordingly, you can see the waveform in both the digital as well as our oscilloscope in the lab. Okay.
Sir, with virtual instrument? Share the virtual instrument.
One second. Yes, sir. I am changing the...
Sir. Sir.
Now, from here is 60. 60 degrees is the firing angle. You can see the CRO output and the virtual output that is displayed in the to my dark. Okay. Now I'm wearing again zero firing angle. Now by wearing up to 60, you can see how the waveform is.
Sir, screen sharing. And select desktop.
Okay.
Second. Screen share and select desktop.
Yes, sir. We'll share it. Yes, sir. Okay. I am doing it.
Sir, sir. Select desktop, sir.
Yes, sir.
Open virtual instrument, sir.
Now it is visible, sir.
Sir, still it has to.
Right, sir.
Sir, Girdhar, sir, me, your desktop, I am sure, I am watching the sharing point arrow mark above itself. Is it so, or you...
The oscilloscope
and multimeter are on the screen. On the screen, they are not visible, sir.
One
second. Share the screen, select the desktop, and then open the multimeter and oscilloscope. Yes, sir. Open share tray. Yes, sir. Okay. Yes, sir. Virtual instrument.
Right.
Multimeter also,
so
sir.
Now I'll vary firing angle. Let me show. Now if
sir, audible? Voice also? Voice?
Zero firing angle. Again, I'm wearing the firing angle. You can see from
sir, run the oscilloscope. Run the oscilloscope. Run.
Yes, sir. I'm
sir.
Running the.
సార్ కొద్దిసేపు వాయిస్ ఆన్ చేయండి కొద్దిసేపు వాయిస్ ఆన్ చేయండి నా ఎక్కడెక్కడ బ్రేక్ అవుతున్నట్టు
the variation. So this is how can even amplitude, amplitude of signal is varied by wearing the load. By varying the load, there's a slight variation in the, as it is a resistive variation in the amplitude also. Right, sir. So this is what from our side, sir.
Sir, thank you, sir. Thank you, Girdhar, sir. Professor Girdhar, sir. So here also that triggering that switching circuits, those are to be interfaced. Little interfacing circuit is required. This is where we are going ahead.
Yes.
And similar circuits are required.
Yes.
So thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Request controller, I am asking, sir. So now I will, sir, you can remove the virtual instrument. Screen sharing you can remove. Okay, sir.
Sir, yeah, remote, sir.
Sir. Okay, thank you, sir. Thanks, sir. Thanks, Professor Girdhar, sir. Shivshankar Babu. Sir, now we will proceed to mechanical department, sir. Shivshankar Babu. He is working on vibration equipment measurement using one of the serial modules. So the virtual like reading as it is. we could see the readouts, the that particular variations. And now I hand it over to Sivasankar Babu. You can proceed with your explanation and show the your setup, and then kindly screen share the readouts. Screen share the that readouts. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. So good afternoon to one and all. Just I will take 5 minutes for the slides, and then we will move to the experimental setup. Just 1 second, I will share the screen. Screen is visible or not, sir?
Your photo is. Please screen share it.
Yeah, already shared, sir. Is it visible?
No. Screen share, select desktop, and then your model analysis. Yes, now it is available.
Yes. Yeah, I am Sivasankar Babu, CH. I'm working as senior assistant professor in the Department of Mechanical Engineering, LVRC, Mailavaram. So we established a small experiment related to the model analysis with the help of CSEC department faculty. So actually, model analysis is the study of model parameters, and that is nothing but dynamic properties of a structure under vibration excitation. Model analysis gives the natural frequency, damping ratio, and mode shifts. These are the main fundamental elements that we, based on these elements only, the structural engineer or all engineers can get the response of the structure. That is nothing but condition monitoring of the structure can be verified by using the model analysis. From the model analysis, you get these the basic three fundamental elements: natural frequency, damping ratio, and mode shifts. Okay, and then the model analysis is used to find the early damage detections, detection of the machinery components or engine components to avoid the catastrophic failures. And also we can find the defects, internal cracks or surface cracks we can identify by using model analysis. So this is also useful to study the vehicle noise as well as vibration control, and the condition monitoring of the structures, engines, machines, etc. Okay, and experimental model analysis to run the experimental model analysis, we need mainly in national instrument environment, we need two types of toolkits. There are sound and vibration toolkit as well as advanced signal processing toolkit. These two are very important. Without these two toolkits, we can't run the experiment. We need these two toolkits. Okay, main of these experimental model analysis is too useful in design validation as well as the finite element analysis verification. Okay, and then the experimental model analysis consists of four steps. First one is we need to select the vibration sensors based on the environmental condition, temperature, pressure, and then ambient conditions. All these parameters we need to consider. We need to select the appropriate sensors based on the environment condition as well as structure type of loading acting on the bodies. We need to maintain that conditions, based on the condition, we need to select the vibration sensor. Second one is the data acquisition. In that, the data is received by the data acquisition system, DAC, from the sensor. That will be processed in the FRF analysis, frequency response function analysis. And from the frequency response analysis, we get the model parameter extraction. That is nothing but natural frequency, mode shift, damping ratio. We can extract from the FRF analysis. This is a flowchart for the model analysis. These are the vibration sensor. We have single axis vibrometer, multi axis vibrometer, and the triaxial accelerometers. Okay. And this is impact hammer, which consists of a load cell. When you hit the body by using impact hammer, that will take the load, that will estimate the load from the load cell. And there are different tips are there based on the structure type and material type. And we can select the type or tip. Rubber, nylon materials used for the soft materials. When you want to find the model analysis of the soft material, we can use rubber as a tip. If you want to analyze the, if you want to find the natural frequency of the heavy engines, we go for a hard material called steel. Like that, we can select the appropriate tool tip. And if the structure is heavy, then we need to add the additional mass on the impact hammer. Okay, then only we get the higher modes of natural frequencies. Okay, this is the impact hammer. And if you want, we can use the vibration shaker also to find the mode shifts and damping ratios by giving the known frequency. Okay, and then this is the data acquisition system. which can process and analyze the signals received from the sensor, above mentioned sensors, and it will send the data to the software. Okay. Here in vibration point of view, we are using 923435 sensor as a DAC system. And then this is a FRF analysis. After receiving the data from the DAC data queuing system, the software itself convert the signals into a frequency response functions. This is a frequency response function in terms of FR magnitude and frequency. The FR of magnitude is nothing but a response, output response divided by input force. The load cell detects the input, how much input force is acting on the structure, and output response from the accelerometer take the ratio, that is called a transfer function. Okay, that is in y-axis and frequency on x-axis. And then model parameter extent from the FRF analysis, we can use different types of fitting methods, peak picking, circle fit, LSCE fit, FDP fit. There are a lot of methods, algorithms are there. We can use MATLAB to analyze this FRF analysis to get the natural frequency, mode shapes, and ratio. This is the model parameter extraction. From the model analysis, we get the frequency and damping ratio here. This is a, by peak picking, that is nothing but this is a peak. This is assumed as taken as a natural frequency. This is vertical, if you draw a vertical line, we get the frequency approximately 270 or 280. 281 is the natural frequency. That is the first natural frequency. We get the second natural frequency at this peak. Like that, we get the number of frequencies. It is a multi-degree of freedom structure. It has a number of natural frequencies. We get the number of natural frequencies from the frequency response function by using different types of fits. Okay, and then we, in our lab, in dynamics lab, we establish a small equipment, experiment that is called as model analysis of beam-like structures. Different types of beam-like structures, we analyzed model, we apply the model analysis to find the model parameters. The main aim of the model, this experiment, is to find the natural frequency, mode shapes, and damping factor. Based on that only, we can calculate the damage identification. Okay, here we take the response from the object without damage and with damage. Once we get the data, from the data, we are able to identify the damage, where the damage is existing or not. If damage is there, at what location the damage is there, we are identify the damage location through the analysis for these two experiments. Okay, in this experiment we have accelerometer. It is on the end of this cantilever beam and cantilever and impact hammer. This is a impact hammer and this is a DAC, and we need software for to run this experiment. Okay, and we get this type of curves. Initial first one is applied load versus time. Initially we are applying single hit. We apply the impact load on the structure by the impact hammer, that displayed in the first graph. And second one is the response of the structure in terms of time signal. This is a time signal. So from the time signal, it is impossible to find the natural frequency, mode shapes. That's why it is converted, the software converts the time signal into a frequency signal. From frequency signal, we get the accurate values, and easily we get the parameters. For that, it is single hit analysis. After after 5 hits, we get the graphs like this. And this is the frequency response function. From these peaks, we get the frequency, natural frequency. By using the half power bandwidth formula, we get the damping factor. And we need to consider the phase angle also here to analyze the natural frequency. Wherever the phase angle changes from plus 180 to minus 180 degrees, at that corresponding frequency is a natural frequency. Remaining peaks are a fake peaks. These are not resonant frequencies. Only we need to consider the phase, where the phase angle changes, at that angle only we need to consider the frequency. And then this is the plate-like structure. We have taken the analysis, we have applied the model analysis for the plate-like structure. Opposite sides are fixed and other sides are free. We have applied the same analysis for the plate-like structure also. and we get the for 25 heads. We take a number of points on the structure to get the mode shapes, so deflected shape of the plate and reaction of the loads. For that, we take number of points. At number of points, we hit the load. Then correspond response is taken by the accelerometer. We get a response like this. We can export the signal into Excel, and we can analyze the signal into MATLAB. Then we get the model parameters.
Very good. So this is the frequency
response for the, yes sir, yes sir. 2 minutes is completed.
Yes sir.
Plate-like structure of frequency response for phase angle. So finally, the main aim of the model analysis is to if the structure is having damage or not, we can identify by using analysis. If damage is there, where the damage is existing, that location can be calculated, and location and depth also we can calculate by using this analysis. Finally, we can apply a prognosis. We can increase the remaining life of the structure by adding some patches or some dampers. Okay, this is the conclusion. Thank you. I will share the screen of the experiment. Otherwise, you can see this experiment from this slide only. Just 1 second.
At the screen, sir.
Yeah, 1 second, sir. Sir, is it visible? Experiment setup is visible?
No, setup is not visible. You are visible as it is, the camera angle.
Just wait 1 second, sir. Now it is open, sir.
Setup, yes, that monitor and this one.
So this is the accelerometer.
More lighting.
This is the impact hammer, this is the tag we are using here. And just 1 second. We can observe the other screen, opposite computer is there. We can observe the screen. Is it visible, sir? Opposite computer screen?
Opposite. This is you are showing through camera. You could share it on the screen.
I will share the screen here.
Please. Please share the screen.
Yeah, is it okay, sir?
Yes, sir.
Here we need to give the configuration. It is in 4-channel data acquisition system. We have 2 sensors in the camera. If you have RTD temperature sensor, you can fix that also. Here there are 2 sensors, one in the applying force, second one in the get a response, then the acceleration. If you want, you can take displacement velocity also. Here I'm taking the acceleration as a response. And these are the settings, configuration. And after that, we get a screen like this. And after fixing, after applying the role of the beam, just give the excitation, the body oscillates, then we get a corresponding signal into this screen like this. Yeah, this is impact floor, first graph. Second graph is a time response. Okay, and this graph is the frequency response function, this graph. Bottom one is phase angle, and top one is coherence. Based on the coherence and phase angle, we can take the correct exact natural frequency from the frequency response function. Okay. Otherwise, we can export these signals into MATLAB. From that, we get the exact natural frequency, mode shapes, and the damping factor. Okay. So this is our experiment. We can apply the model for the plate structure also. This is the plate structure. We can observe here also. We are able to identify the damage location also here. Yeah, we created some damages on the plate. From the analysis, we exactly find out the damage location as well damage width of the plate also. From the structure by using the model analysis only. Where the exact damage is there, how much width it has, and we are able to identify this quartal damage location and identification. This is our experiment we implemented in Dynamics Lab, sir, with the help of EC faculty. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Sir, your voice is not visible, sir. Not audible.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Sri Shankar Babu garu, for demonstrating yes, things. Okay, I am taking the control back. Taking the control back. Sir, as it is, we have gone through the electronics, electrical and mechanical labs. So where we have seen the usage of the NI hardware for interfacing their own setups, and mechanical we have to do much. We have to do much because for their level control, for applying force and then reading the acceleration, reading the pressure, force, almost all the most of the sensors we have to use. As I teach the instrumentation, most of the teaching sensors what we teach are what we come across. These things we have to use and design the interfacing devices, interfacing blocks, so that the MIDAX serial modules could be straight away interfaced to the mechanical equipment and then control, like many of the computer controlled machines. So this is where I request the learned professors, so that from all the departments, whatever the difficulties we are facing as it is, but all the things to be developed to, as far as my observation is concerned, just I have put it in before you. So from your side, if you have any solutions like this, easy solutions and applying the same, so that really we could work together and then use these NI devices which are available with us to be interfaced by for all the setups in every department, and then they could work out their experiments. They could provide their experiments for the students in online. So this is what we're expecting. Basically, this exposure, this as it is, wanted to put it. I want to request. Okay, thank you. Thank you. Thanks for all. Thank you, Mr. Okay. Sarangi. Just. Okay.
Yeah. Thank you so much, sir. I really appreciate the passion from each of the faculty member who wanted to show their demonstration, how they are engaging the students. I may not be surprised if there is a delay in the video streaming, there is a issue in switching over the screen from one faculty member to another faculty member. These all are new, right? Last 40-50 years, we are practiced in teaching some of the classroom laboratory method. So I will not be surprised if this is not looking professional. We are not meant for that, right? So I'm sure all of you are facing the similar issues, but I see a commitment, I see a passion on each of the faculty member, Shivashankaran sir, Giriraj sir, Shivakumar sir. I sincerely appreciate the effort taken by the entire team to engage the students in this tough situation. So I will keep it open for the questions. Audience, if you have a question, please feel free to unmute yourself and ask us.
So rather put their questions in the chat, I believe. In the chat, I believe they will put questions. Or if they can unmute.
Yeah, they can unmute and you can ask the questions also. Because already we have crossed half an hour. We are scheduled for 11:30 to 1, but we have crossed another 30 minutes. But if you have some questions to ask, please feel free to unmute yourself and ask questions quickly so that we can answer a few of them at least now. I'm not able to see how many people are attending. You are able to see, sir?
No. At this moment.
I think because it's a live.
But I got a message from one of the participants that after a delay, they got the meet. They could join the thing.
Okay. Any questions? Can you please ask if you have a question? Okay. In meanwhile, I will also share my screen. I'll go back to the poll, mentee poll. See how many of them are active now. So this is my second question. This same code. Login menti.com, same code 11275. Which is your preference to do engineering? Meanwhile, if you have a question, please unmute yourself and ask questions so that we'll be able to answer. Oh, there is one question in the chat. Let me try to answer. Whether measurement live is possible with LVS2. Okay, measurement live is not a feature of LVS2. It is possible only with LVS3. So there is a question, which NILVS models are compatible for remote lab? LVS3 is the one method. See, right now what is happening, when Professor Shivakumar sir was demonstrating with the NILVS 1 version or NILVS 2 version,
yes.
You have to use Microsoft Teams to share the screen where more than one student can able to get collaborated, connected and able to access. But the LVS3, you no need of any of this. There is a device in your campus. That device is enabled with IoT, and you know the device ID, and you will share the device ID to a group of people, and all the group can able to log in simultaneously and able to perform the experiment of their choice. So no screen sharing is mandate, no Microsoft Teams or Google Meet is mandate. It is basically, there is a device where you are giving access or doing some experimentation for the device. I will also, as a follow-up, send you a detailed demonstration how it can be done. But a very simple, straightforward answer, the measurement live is a feature available on LVS3 platform onwards. Okay, if you don't have much questions, so thank you so much. I really appreciate all the effort taken by LBRCE and inviting me to do a 30-40 minutes of interaction with the faculty members here. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Vishesan, sir. Thank you. Thank you. At this moment, I convey my regards for our principal, sir, who encouraged this and made it possible to happen in a very short time from the time of planning. And I thank all the participants who have registered, and then we had some difficulty in entering into the session, that part. So these things, this make it, I apologize for the mistake, for the difficulty what we have faced. And really I thank, and I see further progress in our developing the modules or drivers for interfacing various experimental setups in different labs to our NI hardware and giving the remote lab access to our other department students also, right? So this will come to a real when at the earliest. Sir, principal, sir,
okay, I'm concluding. Thank you, Vishesh Sringaru. I could not attend the complete session. But it is a great effort to reach the students to strengthen the teaching learning process. So not only theory subjects, we can conduct even experiments also, simulations and all. Really great for sparing your time and accepting your invitation. And at the same time, I would like to thank all the participants also for participating in this particular session, training session. Thank you, thank you.
Thank
so,
you.
Kumar Gar,
sir.
Well done. Good job.
Sir.
Thank
sir,
you.
Sir. Thanks. Sir, I'll come. Sir. So thanks. I will leave.